everyone, and welcome to Collider Movie Talk for movie fans. I'm your host, Natasha Martinez, and this is the daily show where we give you all of the latest news in the world of movies, plus some insight into what it all means. Joining us today is Kristian Harloff.
What's going on, guys? What a special edition of Collider Movie Talk we have today, and what a great panel we're going to have talking about it. Hello, everybody out there. It's nice to see you.
Yes, battling in the movie trivia showdown tomorrow, TV Talk show host Josh Macuga.
Hey, guys. I'm here. I'm ready to talk movies, but also insult Clarke Wolfe's side. Like, it'd be like backhanded compliments.
Well, you can't insult her because yesterday was her birthday. So joining us, Clarke Wolfe.
Thank you very much, Natasha, and whatever, Josh. Hi, guys. It's nice to see you. Thank you all so much for having me.
Okay, now before we get into the topics that you guys are looking at over there, there are a couple stories that dropped that it was soon. Like, we got to talk to the audience about it, so let's get into it. The first thing, we got a confirmation. Guess what? Deadpool 2, it's happening. Tim Miller, I believe, confirmed it. We're ready to go. I am so not shocked. You knew it was going to happen. It made a lot of money. It makes sense that this is going to happen. Fox now pushed away Gambit because they knew that they could do this. You get it out there as fast as you can. If Tim Miller and Ryan Reynolds want to do it and have the story, and you can continue the X-Men universe. It's a brilliant move. It makes a lot of sense. What do you think?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I don't think there was any question or doubt in anyone's mind that we were going to be getting a new Deadpool. Did we see when it's coming? Have they announced a release date?
Anybody over there? No, yeah. Not yet.
Okay, so we just know it's coming. Well, I mean, it makes perfect sense, and I would imagine that the sooner the better. So yeah, I mean, it'll be exciting. It'll be interesting too to see, you know, Deadpool, I feel like, was a big success because I think it injected some self-awareness to the superhero movies that we've all kind of come to expect, and it will be fun to see how Deadpool is received and how it takes it a step further after Civil War, after Batman v Superman, right. After not Apocalypse. What is the X-Men?
Apocalypse. McCooks.
Yeah, I mean, I think Deadpool 2 will make a statement, just like Clark's necklace. I want to see what holidays he does for the marketing campaign. Like, if he, you know, does like Arbor Day, when they're going to release it, or they release it around Valentine's Day, the same thing. The marketing campaign gets me just as excited as Deadpool 2 does.
I think you're absolutely right. It became a thing. It's almost like you can almost say, like, guys, we had such a, you know, they're going to want us to do another one just like that again. I'm probably going to have fun doing it. But yeah, I'm excited for it. All right, the second story that came out to you, there was an image. And the image was of Ghost in the Shell. It's Scarlett Johansson staring out of a window. who cares? Do I want to see the movie? Yes, absolutely. But the image is her in a wig looking out the window. So it doesn't do anything for me. Does it do anything for you?
She's got that posh spice bob. Looks good.
She does.
Yep. I mean, what else am I looking at? Yeah. It just kind of looks like me looking out of a hotel window in Vegas. Like, what happened?
I think it's a pretty good match, though, for there's a side-by-side image out there somewhere that you can see from the original source material. It's a pretty good match with the exception of the fact that she's white. But I mean, it's true. That's been some big controversy around the casting of this movie, is that they did not hire an Asian actress to play this role. But aside from that, you know, it looks like they're going for the authenticity that would match the original source material. So
this is me as a ghost in a nutshell.
The question is, who's going to play the window? Yeah. All right, let's get to the topics that we have right over there. Natasha, what are we talking about first?
Late in the afternoon yesterday, Deadline dropped a report that out of the possible actors on the shortlist to play young Han Solo in the Lord and Miller Star Wars movie, Hail Caesar's Alden Ehrenreich is now considered the frontrunner. Deadline's report says it was the screen test that led to Ehrenreich being considered the best among the three actors, that also included Taron Egerton and Jack Reynor. The story of young Han Solo is set to focus on his days where he met up with his walking carpet of life partner in Chewbacca before he joined up with the Rebel Alliance. The Han Solo film is slated for release on May 25th, 2018. Kristian, what are your thoughts on Alden Ehrenreich as the frontrunner for Han Solo?
Now, everyone is expecting me to go, this is unbelievable! Taron Egerton should be the guy! What's happening? And guess what? Not going to say that. I'm all for it. I am all for it. This guy is a fantastic actor, and when his name popped up in there, he wasn't my first choice, as everybody else out there knows that. But
who was your first choice?
Taron Egerton, okay. For sure. But that being said, what the report is saying also gives me confidence. It's all about that screen test. Mm-hmm. It's what he did in the room. So obviously, the people who are casting the film, who have done a phenomenal job so far casting their Star Wars movies, think that this is the guy. And if this is indeed he turns out to be the guy, then it makes sense. So if the one thing, and he's from L.A., and it's just everything I've seen him in, whether it be Stoker or Beautiful Creatures or Hail Caesar, he's always had kind of like a Southern twang or something too. And I was wondering, maybe he was Southern, but he's not. He's from L.A. So I think he can get rid of that, because you don't want to see Han Solo with the Southern twang. But
I did the Kessel Run in 12 parsecs. All right.
He didn't say that at the end, but the beginning of it was close. but this is a guy. He is a really great actor. And I think the other thing that I think that he has, Taron Egerton is not a guy that is a big, huge star, but he's certainly going to be one.
Yeah.
And with Eddie the Eagle, you saw that he got a lot of, because he was starring against Hugh Jackman, so the press and the people starting to learn about him a little bit more. Kingsman was a huge hit. He's doing another Kingsman movie. So maybe they also wanted to pull back on a guy that does not have that kind of press right now, and that is the John Boyega and Daisy Ridley of this franchise, and so you can see him as just Han Solo. I still think you could have done that with Egerton, but I think that this dude is a great choice. I have no problems with it. Clark?
Yeah, I love the idea of... he's not an unknown, obviously. He's been working in some high-profile films over the last couple of years, but a lesser-known actor. The other thing that I was thinking of was, Chris Pratt's screen test for Guardians of the Galaxy. You know, we've heard the director speak about, you know, how when Chris walked into the room and just started reading, and before that, keep in mind, he was the pudgy guy on Parks and Recreation, and nobody really knew him as anything else. He was Star-Lord, and they just knew it. And so for me, I trust Chris Lord and Phil Miller. I think that what they've done, especially in this action comedy space over the last couple of years, is incredible. I think Channing Tatum owes them probably most of his career, because he broke out in 21 Jump Street. And I think that they're going to do an awesome job with the film. And the fact that they saw something in this screen test, like you said, Christian, is a huge, huge vote of confidence. But basically, for me, it comes down to the fact that if Lord and Miller give it their thumbs up, I trust those guys, and I think they're going to nail it.
No, I did not steal my jacket from Tubbs. Next.
Crockett.
Yeah, Moose Crockett. What do you think?
First of all the names that they were throwing out there were stars trending, and this was like a name I hadn't really heard of. He's the most foreign sounding guy, and this guy is from LA that we've gotten in there. I think one thing that Star Wars always does really well, and even those SNL, those old SNL screen test, remember those ones?
Yeah, sure.
I'm Richard Dreyfuss. I was in Jaws.
Oh, I should have gone.
they take stars that are unknown, or like people that they think are going to be stars or whatever. The casting department in Star Wars knows what they're doing. This Alden Ehrenreich, I mean, throw him in that thing. He looks like a little smartass. You know what I mean? Like, he's up there doing the Kessel Run, hanging out with a walking carpet guy. Give it to him. It's awesome.
Yeah. Okay, what's next?
Things appear to be moving fast for the newly rebooted Spider-Man movie from Marvel and Sony Studios, Spider-Man Homecoming. Before the reboot was named with the title Homecoming, a report hit the internet saying the villain who will act as the primary antagonist against Tom Holland's Spider-Man will be Vulture. And now Variety adds to that report saying Michael Keaton is now in talks for the villain role. Though plot points about his character are being kept under wraps, many fans can't help but notice that Keaton is the perfect age to play Vulture, aka Adrian Toomes. Cop car helmer John Watts is directing the movie from a script by Horrible Bosses scribes John Francis Daly and Jonathan Goldstein. Spider-Man Homecoming opens in theaters on July 7th, 2017. Josh, what do you think about Michael Keaton joining the cast of Spider-Man as a villain?
Oh, I mean, I've been on the show a bunch of times talking about my, not disdain for Spider-Man, but just like overall exhaustion of the franchise. You know, they've rebooted it. This is the third reboot of it. It's like, quit breaking up with your ex-wife and remarrying her. I mean, it's... But obviously, I love Michael Keaton, and I'm from Pittsburgh. He's from Pittsburgh. He's my favorite Batman. I think that there's something about that dude. Listen, Birdman, some people be like, oh, Birdman's going to be Vulture. Ooh, look at that. That's cool casting.
Did they say, oh, look at that?
Look at that. Ooh, that's going to be like
all
that.
All right.
But last week on Movie Talk, when I said three idiotic things, one of the things
what
I did
things?
Say... Wolverine's in the MCU. Right. My bad. Right. Andrew Garfield, I don't remember saying that, but apparently I did, that he was still Spider-Man. He's not. I know, guys. I'm not a moron. I know this. And that it's Rogue One.
Clark
guys,
just got really confident for tomorrow.
Think about this for a second, guys. She's Rogue. She could be a Rogue One. Anyway, what I'm saying is that I said last week that I would love to see Vulture. Vulture was an underrated character in the comic books, and when they were coming with Sam Raimi's Four that Clark brought up earlier, is they were going to have John Malkovich play Vulture, which totally makes sense. He's like a creepy little old bald guy, whatever. Michael Keaton brings that gravitas of like smart aleckness that I think John Malkovich would have just been super serious. Now, does this mean like we're jamming Michael Keaton back in another action franchise or a superhero franchise? That would be cool with me. That would totally be cool with me. I'm down. He's been killing it lately, really.
The Wolf?
Yeah, I'm on board. I love the idea of Michael Keaton doing anything, really. I think he's fan. I want him to do bigger things.
Yeah.
And I love that he is back in the limelight and that this could actually be a thing. And like we were talking off camera and like you just said, you know, they've been wanting to do Vulture for a while in these movies. And I like the idea that we're about to maybe see him. The other thing is, I would say I like Keaton as a villain. Now, I know that the RoboCop remake was not everyone's cup of tea. That's fair. However, I did think that him in this kind of corporate, douchey, businessman, villainish role, I loved that. I thought he was great. And so, you know, as far as I'm concerned, Keaton can do no wrong. Mm. And I love the idea of him. I also like the idea that the script is coming from, you know, some more comedic screenwriters. Because, Josh, I agree with you. I have Spider-Man fatigue. I know you guys have, everybody else apparently has seen Civil War except me, and so that's fine. But, and everybody's talking about how great Spider-Man is, and I think that's exciting. But, you know, before I see Civil War, I have to say I'm exhausted with Spider-Man. But I love this casting.
I wouldn't say I was exhausted from Spider-Man, but I was just like, they're starting to really hurt the character with the movies they were doing. But then I saw Civil War. So bring me Spider-Man. Bring me as many as you can. Bring me the collaboration between Sony and Marvel. Give me, give me, give me. And the other thing that I want is Michael Keaton. Oh, you mean like I should be over. I want to see Michael Keaton.
How dare you?
Yeah, I want to see him as Vulture. I want to see him in one of these movies. And I also think it's a great opportunity to have him in the Spider-Man movie in the MCU. Mm-hmm. So now whether or not he craps out at the end of this movie or whether or not he lives on and then continues on and maybe pops into another MCU movie, cool. I think that's kind of what you'd want to do if you get a talent like Michael Keaton, but you never know what the story is going to tell or what they're going with. But yeah, I mean, who doesn't want to add Michael Keaton right now? And exactly what you said, he's back in the limelight, whether it be Birdman or any of these movies that he's popping into that he's kind of getting. I mean, look at Spotlight.
I mean, Spotlight. Two best picture movies. Yeah. I mean, that's ridiculous.
He's got his career back, and he's got it, and it's because he
disappeared. He went to his ranch in Montana.
He turned down a lot of stuff.
Absolutely.
But he did Herbie Fully Loaded, which obviously not the best. And that one he did like an indie with Jane Lynch and Alexis Bledel. I forget what that was called. Catherine Reitman was actually
I don't know.
One of them.
Anyway, he was in that movie.
Yeah. So I'm on board, man. I think that it's great to have him involved. So how about you guys? Are you guys excited that Michael Keaton is going to be in this? And the other question I have for viewers out there, the younger viewers that maybe were not familiar with Michael Keaton 3-4 years ago, and then maybe you were introduced to him, whether it be Birdman or Spotlight. How did you discover Michael Keaton if you're a younger film goer?
Go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, or on SNL last year where he was fantastic.
Right. And if you guys go back and watch Michael Keaton's early filmography
in anything,
Nighthawks. Gung Ho might be one of the greatest movies of the 80s.
Stallone. I'm thinking of the other one. Yeah. Night Shift.
Are any of you guys Johnny Dangerously?
Oh, of course.
Yeah.
My mother kicked me in the balls once.
Once. You guys, the thing that's so funny that people don't remember about Michael Keaton, and I've said this other places before, is I think Keaton could have had Tom Hanks's career. Keaton is just as funny and just as talented. But, you know, sometimes whatever, for personal reasons, maybe it doesn't gel. Maybe, you know, when you are the biggest thing in the world and Batman was the biggest thing in the world, that's a lot of pressure. Yeah. And especially at a time where you didn't have a superhero movie coming out every 2 months.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm so glad that he's back, but Kristian and Josh are absolutely right. Like, go back and watch more Michael Keaton. Mm-hmm. Multiplicity.
Yeah. Well, remember also the thing is that he's in talks for the villain as well. It's this heavy kind of rumored when they come this Fast and Furious, it turns out, like, again, with our Han Solo story, seems like that's going to be the guy. It seems like Keaton's going to be the guy to play the villain. So he's in talks, but it just, it's us getting excited whether or not he's going to be in it. Yeah. So, okay, Keaton Natasha, crush. What's next?
It looks like Shane Black's Predator movie is next for the director after his latest The Nice Guy lands in theaters May 20th. This according to an exclusive interview with our very own Steve Frosty Weintraub, who spoke to him about the status of his Predator film that Black is describing as an event film. Though Black dodged direct questions about whether or not Arnold Schwarzenegger will be involved with the movie, one question he did answer was in regards to the time frame the movie would take place in. Black confirmed that the movie will be set in present day. This new Predator movie is due out March 2nd, 2018, 31 years after the events from the original film. How this will affect plot and story is anybody's guess. Clarke, are you excited for the new Predator movie that will take place in present day?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes, I am. I grew up watching Predator with my dad, and I love these movies. And, well, I do love the first one. I actually haven't seen the second one.
What?
I know. A lot of people...
Second one's actually pretty good.
I know. A lot of people tell me that. So yeah. I need... Isn't Gary Busey in the second one?
No, Gary Busey and Danny Glover.
Danny Glover was a good friend of mine until I ate a bagel. Then he asked me to put it on my head.
I can't wait. That was the best endorsement for Predator 2 ever. Predator's not my favorite. But I love Shane Black. I love these characters. And as far as it being like, or I love the Predator. And as far as it being set in modern day, I mean, okay. Like, what was it going to be set? In the 80s? I don't, you know.
Like, where they take it back to the jungle? Or they do, you know, like they did Predator 2. They did it in an urban environment. We did Predator 2 back in the day on Guilty Movie Pleasures. I know a lot of people don't like it. Because it's so different from the first one, and they put Danny Glover. I mean, Bill Paxton's in it as like this young rogue cop. It's a really
game over, man.
Yeah.
Game over.
But since they made that movie, they've done like Alien versus Predator and like Predator Island or whatever. It's like the Bachelor Pad. Who knows what they've done with Predator? But any kind of excitement about bringing the Predator back into the human world, I'm super excited about.
What the hell are you?
If it bleeds, we can kill it.
Everyone has been asking me whether or not I'm going to be in this movie. Of course I'm going to be in this movie. Can Shane Black say it? No. Why would he? He's not going to tease it. He's not going to tell you the truth. I'll tell you, because I don't lie. It doesn't matter what it is. I won't tell you about the maid, but other things, I'm going to tell you about stuff. It doesn't matter. I'm going to be in the movie. I'm going to kill the Predator. I'll be in it for 2 hours. I'll be in it for 4 hours. It doesn't matter. Come back and watch it.
Son of a bitch.
Kill him.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
So the movie is something I'm looking forward to. I actually hope they retcon Predator 2. Get rid of it. It's a movie you don't have to see. Is it a fun, guilty movie pleasure? Yes, and it deserved to be on that show and stay there. It's a silly movie. And if you go back and watch, it's incredibly dated, but the first one is one of the best movies, one of my favorite movies of all time. And I love that Shane Black is returning to the franchise because not only was he in the movie, the first film, he wrote a majority of it, if not all of it. But he knows it. He's going to come back. You know he's been talking to Arnold about it. So I love that it's present day. I love what's happened. So that's why I'm wondering if the events of the second one happen. If they do, they just kind of go over it, and whether or not Gary Busey will try to eat the next Predator. I love it. I love the timeline. I love everything that Shane Black said. So I'm on board. It is time for buy or sell. Pretty simple how it works. Natasha's going to read down some more stuff happening in the world of movies. And both Josh Macuga, Clarke Wolfe, and my jacket will say whether or not it's going to be a buy or sell. All right, Natasha, what do you got?
Matthew Vaughn's Kingsman: The Golden Circle continues to add an impressive cast to the lineup, with Channing Tatum the latest actor to come on board. Tatum confirmed his casting with a tweet last night saying, "I'm about to get up all in that Golden Circle." That's three new Americans on board, now with Tatum joining Halle Berry and Julianne Moore, even with Elton John cast in a yet unknown role. Kingsman: Golden Circle is written by Vaughn and Jane Goldman and will star Taron Egerton and Mark Strong. Filming begins soon with a 2017 release date. Kristian, does your jacket buy or sell Channing Tatum in Kingsman: The Golden Circle?
Jacket definitely buys Channing Tatum. Do I buy it? Yeah, I kind of buy it. I think that he'll be fun in this role. The thing that I hope happens, though, is we know that he was really good in both 21 and 22 Jump Street. He nailed comedy the way we were not expecting him to nail comedy. But the Kingsman is a little bit of both there, too. So I don't want it to just be overhammed, but I also think he's a guy that takes direction well. Mm-hmm. I think that he's a guy that could... I don't want it to be, and it wasn't the Channing Tatum show in the last, oh my God,
like,
no, Hateful Eight. In Hateful Eight, it wasn't his show in that. So when he's asked to play kind of backup roles, he does it. Mm-hmm. And I just don't want it to. I want front and center to be Eggsy. I want to see now this new focus on both Halle Berry and Julianne Moore. But I think depending on how he's used and if Matthew Vaughn is confident in him, then yeah, I buy it. Cooks?
Yeah, I'd buy it. I love Channing Tatum. I love how we all. You're like, what was the last one he was in? I was like, Magic Mike XXL.
Yeah, right.
Action comedy, great in the Jump Streets. Obviously, those should be nominated for Oscars every year that they come out. I think it would be kind of cool if they used him as a villain in Kingsman Social Circle, Secret Circle, Golden Knights.
Let's not go there. All right, next.
No, Clark didn't get a chance.
Oh, no, not that next topic. Oh. I was saying next. Let's get away from the Golden Circle. Yeah. All right, Clark.
Okay, so I cautiously buy this, and the reason I cautiously buy it actually has nothing to do with Channing Tatum. I'm worried that we're overloading this movie.
Right.
So the rumors that maybe Colin Firth is coming back, even though one of the last times I was on Movie Talk, he wasn't coming back. So maybe he is. Now you've got Halle Berry, you've got Julianne Moore, you've got Elton John, which I was like, what? Like, I love Elton John, don't get me wrong, but it just is starting to make me a little concerned that maybe we're going for too much flash over substance. Now, I trust Matthew Vaughn. I love him. I think he's one of the best directors working today. But yeah, it just makes me a little nervous.
But what if there's a scene where basically how I envision the Elton John in this thing is he's playing at a concert, right? And then he starts doing Crocodile Rock and they start killing everybody like they did to Freebird.
Yes, that would be
Crocodile
badass.
Rock killing montage?
That would be amazing.
If he's a spy, I'll love it.
Yeah.
All right, what's next?
Although the Warner Brothers adaptation of the classic Peter Pan story, Pan, failed with both the box office and with critics, Disney is hoping their magic can write that namesake, setting David Lowry to direct another live-action version of Peter Pan. This according to a report from Variety. Lowry is also known for directing the indie Ain't Them Body Saints and is also helming another Disney project, the live-action version of Pete's Dragon, which is set for release this August 12th. The latest news of Disney suggests is pleased with Lowry's version of Pete's Dragon and wants the same magic touch to work on their Peter Pan adaptation. The movie is currently being written by Toby Halbrooks and no release date has been set. Josh, buy or sell another live-action Peter Pan from Disney?
I mean, sell. Are they just pigeonholing this director into movies with people named Pete? If you think I've got Spider-Man exhaustion, Peter Pan exhaustion, look, they did a live one on TV. They did Pan. I don't understand why we keep just crushing this horse. We're not getting a new story from Peter Pan. And okay, everybody hates Hook. I didn't mind Hook. I liked Hook. I know I'm getting crushed on sequels today. You
liked
Hook?
I liked Hook, yeah.
A lot of people do.
Bam-a-ring,
okay, listen,
Bam-a-ring.
Pan stunk. Okay, Peter Pan is an iconic character that you don't need another movie about. You just don't need it. For them to like put all this money and be like, look, kids, we can have a Peter Pan too, just doesn't make much sense to me.
I just love Zeno Hour's comment was, Pan was panned. I'll see myself out. Well done. Well done.
Well done,
I am actually going to buy it. And but I understand everything that you said. And I get that there's a lot of cells in the chat room right now that are saying, another Peter Pan. Peter Pan, my God, give it up. Peter Pan is not working. Leave it alone. It just isn't working. If they keep trying, and no. I hated Pan. It was awful. And the Smells Like Teen Spirit song out of nowhere. I mean, it was horrible. It was enough to make me just quit watching movies. But I want to also say that you have to go off a Jungle Book. You have to go off of Cinderella. Maleficent didn't happen. But you have to go off those last two movies. And what they want to do is it's going to be more of a playoff, not just the classic Peter Pan novel, but it's going to be more a tale of the animated film that they, I think it was the 50s when they put it out. So the team that is doing that right now has... I've got confidence in that team right now. Now, but I also understand where it's just like it's gonna be tough because everybody's exhausted with Peter Pan. You're not doing like if you say you're doing Aladdin, people are like, cool, I want to see Aladdin, Little Mermaid. All right, great, let me check that. I'm Mulan. Yes, please. Peter Pan has just been done to death. Now, if nobody had done Peter Pan at all, Like, no one. And then Disney announced it. You're like, yes, please, but it's exhaustion. So I get it, but I'm still going
to
buy it.
Well, I think you're, okay, I think your reasoning for, you know, trusting the team to adapt the former, the earlier cartoons into the live action, especially looking at something like Cinderella, which I loved, Jungle Book, I loved. You're right. That is a good way to think about it. And I think it's a huge vote of confidence that they're really happy with Pete's Dragon, that they're locking this guy into something else. However, I am totally going to sell this because I am with you, Josh. I am so over Peter Pan. And I totally forgot about the live TV the one? TV one.
Who played Peter Pan? Julianne Hough?
Oh, no. that was Reese.
No, that was Reese.
No, but it was Christopher Walken. Oh, no, he played Chris. Allison.
Oh, Allison Williams.
Williams, yes. So, look.
20 pounds of salmon.
I have a hook.
We're exhausted of Peter Pan. And there's something about it that is not quite clicking with audiences today. Maybe that's because it hasn't been done right, or maybe it's just not the right time. What I would say is I think that Disney needs to maybe take a lesson from Marvel. And what I mean is, I have friends who watch.
They own Marvel.
Well, no, I know.
She means the Disney division that's making the
movie. Yeah. They because I have friends who watch Once Upon a Time, and they say that Captain Hook's arc is one of the most interesting, compelling things that is in that show, and that the show has actually gotten great. You know, maybe some characters need to kind of hang out on Netflix or hang out on TV.
You mean you didn't like the rendition of Pan of me, Captain Hook, or my Jack Nicholson? I can't tell.
So what was that?
What? Jack Nicholson was in
No, but Garrett, who was it?
Dustin Hoffman.
No, Garrett Hedlund in Pan was
you know, eventually I'm going to turn into Hook, and where's my hand? Oh, you ever see that coming?
Good. You saved me having to watch the movie. Yeah, Thank you for that. So I think Disney would be wise to maybe not go for everything and adapting everything into a live action film, and maybe really giving it a little bit more thought is all I'm saying.
I mean, come on. That was a good Hook. Come on.
I did singing, the tap dance.
Dancing.
With the pirates.
Let's dance. All right. Before this gets any uglier. yes. What's next?
Gladly. Mark Rylance is quickly becoming Steven Spielberg's favorite actor to work with. He will next be seen voicing and doing the mocap work for Spielberg's The BFG, with other outlets reporting Rylance will also be joining Spielberg's next drama adaptation, The Kidnapping of Edgardo Mortara. Now add one more part to that mix. The Hollywood Reporter is reporting that Rylance has been added to the already promising cast of Spielberg's science fiction epic Ready Player One, in which he will play James Donovan Halliday, the man who created the Oasis system at the center of the film. He joins the actors already cast in Ben Mendelsohn, Simon Pegg, Ty Sheridan, and Olivia Cooke. Filming is set to begin soon, with a release in theaters set for March 30th, 2018. Clark, buy or sell Mark Rylance in Ready Player One?
Sure, I buy it. I buy it because, you know, he and Spielberg clearly have a great relationship. I have a fact check question that I'm sure internet could probably tell me.
Hello, internet?
Internet?
Tis me, Clark.
Yes,
will Josh
question.
Win the schmildown? Perhaps.
Perhaps.
Thank you.
So, my question is, I'm pretty sure that Rylance is one of the only, if not the only actor to win the Oscar being directed by Spielberg. Ooh, is that right? I think it is.
I think Mark Riley will have
Mark
an answer
Riley
for us.
Sure. That.
Is that right?
Is Mark Rylance the only actor to win an Oscar after being directed by Spielberg?
Yeah.
You let us know in 5 minutes?
Well, anyway, regardless, he's the most recent. We know that.
The fact that Clark doesn't know this bodes well for me in the Schmodown.
Yeah, right? This random piece of trivia bodes really well for you in the Schmodown.
Oh, spicy.
Sick burn, y'all. No, but to get back to it, clearly they have a great relationship. That's fine. Plus, I think he adds a little bit of critical weight. Not to say that the other actors are not, you know, beloved by audiences and critics alike, but I think, you know, having an Oscar winner in this fun pop culture science fiction epic is a great thing.
Huge, huge buy here. And here's the thing that poor Mark Rylance has going against him, is that he won the Oscar against Sylvester Stallone.
Yeah.
Because I know many people that are unfairly saying, why is this guy in this movie now? And why are they using him? And oh, he wasn't that good. He is one of the best classically trained theater actors working today. He is one of the best talent that you can... You didn't know who he was because... He's a character actor.
He's been in everything. Look up his IMDb page.
And
I looked today.
Now he's out there in the forefront, and he should be. I didn't like Bridge of Spies. I thought it was okay. I don't want to say I didn't like it, but I thought it was okay. He stole the movie from Tom Hanks. He stole the movie from Steven Spielberg. He was great in the movie. He's the best part about the film, and I love that he's going to be in the BFG, and I love that he's going to be in this movie too. I really want to read Ready Player One because I hear great things and people love it. So I think it is great to have him out there. I think it is. I like that Spielberg's using him a lot more because it's like yeah, he's the one. Spielberg is responsible for putting him in the forefront here. So yeah, huge buy.
I'm definitely buying. I loved that he won the Oscar. I thought Mark Ruffalo was better than Stallone. Thought maybe Mark Ruffalo should have got the Oscar. But Mark Rylance, again, like you said, he's a character actor. He's been in so much stuff. This goes to show you, if you're an actor out there, you're young and you're watching the show and you're like, I want to be an actor, I want to be something. If you work hard enough and you get a break, you need that one break. Like, he's been a character actor. He's been on stage. He's been working his tail off, scraping by, doing, and then finally he gets his break at such an old age, and you just, once you're given that break, knock it out. And all the props to Mark Rylance in the world. Now he's getting his due. Fantastic.
Daniel Day-Lewis won for Lincoln.
Oh, yes, that's right. Lincoln. So he's the second.
All right. Yeah. So that is everything that we're talking about with buy or sell. And we're going to get into mailbag right about. No, we're not. That's not what we're going to do at all. No, we're going to talk about what's coming out this week. And I decided to talk to myself, and then myself said, no, we have something else to do. That is going to be opening this week. Opening this week brought to you by our friends over at AMC Theaters. Natasha, what is opening this week?
Barbershop, The Next Cut. To survive harsh economic times, Calvin and Angie have merged the barbershop and beauty salon into one business. The days of male bonding are gone as Eddie and the crew must now contend with sassy female coworkers and spirited clientele. As the battle of the sexes rages on, a different kind of conflict has taken over Chicago. Crime and gangs are on the rise, leaving Calvin worried about the fate of his son. Together, the friends come up with a bold plan to take back their beloved neighborhood.
I saw this movie last night, and I had never seen one of the Barbershop movies too. And Mark was telling me he had seen the first one, he liked it, and I didn't know what to expect going in. I thought it was just going to be a pure kind of like, kind of like just joke after joke after joke. I'll tell you what, there was a lot of drama in it. The drama to me hit more than the jokes did. There were some jokes that it feels like kind of like a stage play at some points, because there's a lot of dialogue, and it's like there's a lot of, you can see the blocking as where they're going to hit their moments and then give their speech. And but I thought that the story to where Ice Cube is really wants to take care of his family now and wants to move them out of the there's so much violence happening in their particular neighborhood, so he wants it to go. And it's like the relationship between him and his kid was what I really responded to, and I thought that there were some nice like emotional moments that I wasn't expecting from this movie. But I thought a lot of the jokes kind of fell flat. I thought that Cedric the Entertainer was really good, and I thought Ice Cube was always great, but I thought some of the other side characters...
Ooh, like Nicki Minaj?
She actually wasn't that bad.
Really?
No, she wasn't that bad. Okay. I went in kind of prejudging him. Ah, she's going to be terrible, because she was in that movie with Cameron Diaz.
The Other Woman.
Oh, my Lord, was that a stink bomb from Garbage Town. But she was good in this. But the movie's okay. It's fine. Any interest?
Sure.
Yeah. All right.
No, I. You know, look.
They kill 8 people in the barbershop, and now you have to find the killer.
What?
And his name is, I don't know. I'm just trying
now
to make
I'm
a horror
interested.
Film.
No, yeah. Look, I love Ice Cube. I admire him a lot as a producer. And I think that this franchise, you know, the fact that it's still going is really important. And I was reading a review recently that said that the movie has a lot of social relevance as well, and I think that that's great. You know, it needs. Whatever they're discussing needs to be discussed. So I think it's very cool that it's coming out, and I'm sure it will do well at the box office.
Yeah.
I've always just been really jealous of how cool black barbershops look. Like, yeah. I want to be able to hang out in those, like if we had those in our neighborhood. I've seen both barbershop. I enjoy them. I'm a simple guy when it comes to comedies. Everybody knows that. I won't go see it in the theaters, but I will wait until it comes out, and I'll definitely watch it.
Natasha, have you seen any of the barbershop movies?
I have not, and I... probably will not. It just doesn't draw anything to me. I mean, yeah. I guess maybe I'd like to see Nicki Minaj in it because I like her music. But
I definitely was pleasantly surprised by the actual story and the emotion.
Yeah.
So, okay, we're gonna get to mailbag now. But before we do that, I want to also let you guys know that you can get your Twitter questions in. We're going to do live Twitter questions. Now, we're going to do, obviously, movies, because that's what we talk about in this show. But we can do behind-the-scenes stuff. And if you have any comments or questions about these two in the Schmodown, make sure that you do that at Collider Video. Natasha's going to be looking for those as well, too, because I'm curious to what you guys are saying out there as far as who's going to win and any questions you have about these two. But you guys have asked some questions throughout the week, and we've got one this week that you guys have wrote in. What is it?
Matthew Goster writes, "Hi guys, with the book Harry Potter and the Cursed Child out in July, will Warner Brothers make a movie or wait till Fantastic Beasts series is done? Will Warner Brothers have two Harry Potter series at one at the same time, a Harry Potter movieverse? Thanks."
What do you think?
I think they probably will. I think Warner Brothers is scrambling a little bit right now, and they're missing the days where they had a Harry Potter movie coming out every other Christmas or whatever it was. And I think Harry Potter, they're investing in that brand in terms of their theme parks. They just opened here in Los Angeles, the Wizarding World. I think that they are not going to hesitate.
I would be dumb not to. I love Harry Potter, loved all the books, loved all the movies. I'm looking forward to the Beast of the Southern Wild Harry Potter movie, right? What's is that called? Beast and Newts of Gargantuanville. Give me like a Harry Potter multiverse. It sounds great.
I think it sounds great. I would like to see how this movie does in the theater in November. We all know that it's going to do gangbusters. We know the movie's going to crush. And I think that it would be nice to see Daniel Radcliffe as an older Harry Potter come back. But it's, and it won't happen without J.K. Rowling, and it shouldn't, J.K. Rowling. So I would really hope that she has more stories to tell. She doesn't seem like someone, I mean, look, we know that she likes money, but she doesn't seem like someone who's going to taint her legacy with just throwing out, oh, yeah, I'll make another Harry Potter. Well, yeah, sure, why not? Why not? It's got to be a story to it. So if they can make it a shared universe and then do kind of what the Bourne didn't do. Remember, they were trying to do that with Jeremy Renner, where they were going to introduce this brand new character in the same world, and then you were going to have kind of Bourne come back, and they might still do that, but I don't think that the third Bourne was.
Yeah.
And it's such a smaller scale than the Harry Potter movies, but you hear what I'm saying. Yeah. Okay, before we get into the live Twitter, there was some news that just broke. Variety is reporting that James Cameron, Avatar, right?
Yeah.
Is going to be making 4 Avatar sequels.
On TV?
4. Yeah, on TV.
You're gonna be covering
it on TV Talk for the next 6 months.
Yep, exactly.
No, it is. So here's what Variety was saying, that James Cameron will make 4 Avatar sequels, promising that the films will start hitting theaters in 2018. The next time I see you will be on Pandora, Cameron told a crowd of theater owners at CinemaCon on Thursday. The other 3 films were released 2020, 2022, and 2023. The director told exhibitors that the pictures will be filmed concurrently, and each picture will be a standalone story that combines to form a complete saga. Originally, Cameron had intended to make...
Sequels.
I'm still reading. Sorry. Originally, Cameron had intended to make 3 follow-ups to his mega-grossing 2009 smash, but he said that the story mandated that more films be made. Of course, that's reported by Variety. All right, let's talk about the 4 sequels. I think this is ambitious.
Yeah.
At 4 sequels?
That's insane.
Look, here's the thing. I like the first movie, and I'll defend the fact that
it's Ferngully.
It is. It's Dances with Wolves. It's a million movies that's been done before, but I really enjoyed it, and I thought that whether you love it or hate it, you can't deny that it is a spectacle to look at when it came out in the movie theater. And I still like it when I go back and watch it. I think Sam Worthington was actually really good in it as well, too. 1 sequel? 2 sequels? I can
trilogy.
Get a, sure. When you start pushing to 4, you either have to be so confident that this is your next Star Wars or Marvel, because that is your, I mean, and I get it. James Cameron has done enough to where you say, it's Cameron, let him go. And he's always doing something bigger than the next thing. When Titanic came out, oh, this movie's going to bomb. There's no way people are going to spend money to see the story about the Titanic anymore. Top grossing movie of all time. What the hell is Avatar? This guy hasn't made a movie since Titanic, and he's coming out with this some blue people movie? Highest grossing movie of all time. So it's easy to say, what are you doing with 4 sequels? But then you say it's James Cameron and he's got a plan. He always goes in with a plan. I think it's a lot, but who knows? You hate this.
I think that this is a little excessive.
Yeah.
I think
just a bit.
Just a bit. And, listen, I do want to point out that that now, you know, competition for franchises and major blockbusters and world building, you know, it's a different ball game than when Avatar came out. We've got Star Wars, we've got Marvel, we've got DC, we've got tent poles year round all the time. Audiences, I don't know if they're hungering for this universe to continue for the next 10 years of their movie going lives. I mean, Jiminy, that's a lot.
Jiminy is right. I didn't love Avatar. I wasn't like jonesing to go back and see it again. I mean, the effects were fantastic. Again, okay, are these scripts going to be so good that these standalone films are going to be sucked? What are you going to do, a standalone piece about the big flappy things? Like, I don't...
And it's called the big flappy things, what Variety said.
And unobtainium, ooh, that was some really good pun work there, guys. Like, I don't see the need at all for another Avatar movie, let alone four more.
I can see the need for one because the first one was the most profitable movie of all time.
Okay.
But it ended. No, they set it up for a sequel. It was set up for a sequel. But still, I four is a lot.
Four,
you're asking, because the other thing with Avatar you have to realize is that people started, and this was also when that movie came out. Yeah, the MCU was kind of, it was on a run, but it wasn't at the MCU that we know today. So like, people are saving their money for certain movies, and Star Wars wasn't coming back out too. So it's got a lot more competition now. But it also, the thing, when you have Avatar coming out, you've got to be so confident that the second one is going to, that people want to see, because there's a lot of hate for Avatar. When it came out, you can't blind yourself as a producer and say, just because it was the number one movie, everyone loved it so much. No, it had a lot of backlash afterwards, mm-hmm. too, because it was more
for like the shock value that people went to see, because like, what did James Cameron do with his new camera stuff? Ooh, it looks amazing. Blue people, cool.
Well, I think that's also another thing to consider, is the fact that James Cameron himself wants to spend the next however many years in this universe. Will he direct all four? Now that's a question.
I think he is. Yeah,
I mean, I don't think a guy like Cameron's going to let other people touch his property.
He's not. He's going
to
be directing.
What will we see? I would like to see other things from him.
Well, they said that. Well, he doesn't do
like
that.
Aquaman.
Remember when he did Titanic, he like went down to the Titanic after the movie and stayed there. He was just he was doing research. He didn't do any movies. There was nothing until Avatar. And now it's Titanic and it's Avatar. This is the world he wants to live in. And he said that they're shooting it all like seemingly at once. So you would assume he's going to do it. But like I'm saying, I'm reading the chat room here. There's not a lot of people that are saying, "Oh, I can't wait. This is a great movie." It's everyone going, one sequel will be enough. I don't really care about Avatar. It's kind of baffling that they would do four sequels, but it's James Cameron, so you never know.
Back in Blue.
Yeah.
Avatar 2.
See what I like that.
Back in Blue.
Yeah.
All right. This summer.
What do we have from the live Tweety Tweets?
From the Tweety Tweets, Bazinga Guy asks, thoughts on Deadpool directors saying they want to use the same budget as Deadpool 1 for the sequel?
Ooh, I love that.
I love it too.
Working restraints.
Listen, whether or not they're going to, but the difference is this, that remember, they had to cut, I think it was like, $12 million off the budget like a week before shooting. So that's why in Deadpool, when he's got to go back, he's like, I got to go back and get the guns. He's like, I'm not going to get the guns because they cut out a big scene. And this time, I'm curious if he's like, I forgot the guns. Well, go get them. That's what's going to happen this time. Right. It's nice. And I think that he's right to say, okay, look, I think that the money should go more towards talent. If they're going to spend it on some talent, depending on who they want to get in the movie, they want to bring in, like, I don't want to spoil Deadpool, but they even played on why they had to show certain characters because they couldn't afford other ones. So maybe they tie in the universe a little bit more, spend that money there. But you don't need to spend a lot of money on Deadpool 2 if you want to have the same exact kind of feel that you got from the first one.
I love, Bill Murray talked about it in a really cool interview about Caddyshack and the 30th anniversary of it, and saying that because they had to work in such constraints and timelines and budgetary concerns, they were able to really like juice out the beautiful comedy and such things like that. A lot of these movies are prey to these enormous budgets because they can do whatever they want. They're like, well, I don't know, we'll throw in an explosion there. When you work inside of a box, but outside of a box, beautiful things happen.
Some of the stuff I liked the most in Deadpool was the talking.
Yes.
I want to see these relationships. I want to see these people. And not to say that if you had more money, you can't have talking too, but I think the temptation is to, like you said, more explosions, more this, more that. Let's keep it. I think we like these characters. We want to spend time with the characters. And if you are distracted or by trying to plan the biggest and best fight sequence of the year or green screens or this or that, it's kind of just like, let's keep the intimacy. Let's let these actors do what they're great at.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, what's next?
Okay, Bazinga Guy also asks, thoughts on Warner Brothers making a Hanna-Barbera cinematic universe?
Hanna Barbera.
I don't know. Barbera, I mean, the Flintstones wasn't the pinnacle of what we should be judging.
Isn't it Scooby Doo? Like, and it's a universe that's built out of Scooby Doo.
Right? Yogi Bear, Hanna
Barbera. Well, he is, but I think if I'm not mistaken, the thing that's gonna launch it, this extended universe, is Scooby Doo.
Again? Didn't we already do that?
Yeah,
we're doing it again.
Oh, we are doing it again.
And then other characters will live in that universe.
I don't know. I mean, let me see the first one. I'm just so when I see these things too, and I know it's different, but I just think of the Smurfs, and then I go into Night Terrors. So no, thank you.
Poor John Goodman.
Yeah, no, thank you. Okay, what's next?
Okay, Van Spear asks, what's your anticipation level for the Jack Reacher sequel, Never Go Back, due out in October?
Now, I didn't like the first Jack Reacher. Some people did, but I'm actually excited for the second one because I believe McQuarrie is doing the second one, and I really liked what they did together on the last Mission Impossible film. So I am not ruling it out just because I didn't love the first one. There were some scenes in the first movie that I really liked, and I think that there were, from what I hear about the books, there's a lot of cool stories to be told. So I'm definitely looking forward to it. I think it's funny. We got a question a long time ago, whether it's Twitter or mailbag, and it was, what movie did you not like the first one, but you liked the second one better? This might be my answer to that question. Mm-hmm. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I didn't see the first one, so I can't really weigh in on whether I'm excited for a second one. But what I can say is that I am loving everything Tom Cruise is doing lately.
Yeah.
I think he's doing cool stuff, even when it doesn't work. When I say, you know, like Night and Day, I think it's charming that they tried to do something like that. I thought Edge of Tomorrow was great. I loved Mission Impossible, Rogue Nation. Thank you. I almost said Ghost Protocol. But I love the tone. I love the humor. I think he's cool. He's cool again. Tom Cruise is cool again. So, you know, if he's on board, it's going to be something interesting.
I love the first Jack Reacher because it was shot in Pittsburgh. I didn't necessarily love the movie. I thought it was good. I think, again, like you said, it's one of those cool, like, Tom Cruise, spy, crush, villain. I'm excited to see kind of what they do. But again, I'm not like, I can't wait to see Jack Reacher. It's sort of like lunch at a food court. Like, this is going to be pretty good. You know, it's not going to fail, but it's not like I'm going to Mastro's.
Chat room is yelling at me, and I'm glad that they did. I am fully aware that McQuarrie directed the first one, even though I didn't like it, but he's not coming back for the second one. I guess Ed Zwick is doing the second one.
Okay.
McQuarrie's coming back for the next Mission Impossible.
Right. And you know what it was? Isn't he? And he's co-writing Edge of Tomorrow.
Edge of Tomorrow.
Yeah. That's what
we
it was.
About that
okay.
Last week.
So Ed Zwick doing it. Yeah. I mean, they worked on Last Samurai. You talked to Ed Zwick recently.
Oh yeah, you talked to Zwick.
I thought for the Tobey Maguire movie.
For Pawn Sacrifice.
Right.
Yeah.
All right. What's next?
Okay, Adam Flex asks, hi guys, do you think the Avatar movies will be direct sequels to the first or maybe spin-offs within the same universe?
You have to assume maybe that's the case
now.
Well,
I think, isn't that what the article said, though, is standalone? Doesn't it use the word standalone?
It says standalone, so, I mean, that form into a big
saga. Yeah, so I think, you know, again, gosh, extended universe. If somebody copywrote the word extended, the term extended universe, they would be gazillionaires right now.
There's like, you hear that violin music like the saga of Avatar. Yeah. Okay, it's not Casablanca.
All right, what's next?
Travis Montgomery asks, do you think the reason that Michael Bay's movies are not that good is because he has such a huge budget, hence all the explosions?
Some of his movies are not bad. Who's saying Michael Bay's movies are bad?
I think Transformers are not good.
Wait, did he do the... I'm kidding. Yeah. Bad Boys 2 is the greatest movie ever. We all know that. It's great across the board. Thanks, Adam. Appreciate that. I think that he is given such a large budget, but he does awesome things with it. What he doesn't do with the budget is write a script with it.
Right.
I think that's a hard part.
Yeah, with Michael Bay, I liked Pain and Gain. I don't care for the Transformers movies. I like the stuff he did in the 90s. I like a lot of Michael Bay movies. Mm-hmm. I think Michael Bay has become synonymous with Transformers, and Transformers have been synonymous with crap over the last couple of years. And so, you know, look, I don't think it's the budgets that get in the way. I think, it's the lack of script and story.
Yeah, there's tons of budgets that... You know, look at Nolan, what he did with Batman, Dark Knight. Big budgets. J.J. Abrams had a big budget, and there's a big budget for Civil War. So big budgets don't mean crappy directors, big explosions. It means that a guy who just makes things look pretty sometimes and doesn't concentrate on story. It's like, hey, we should concentrate on why these robots are here from Cybertron. No, let's focus on Mark Wahlberg's daughter's behind.
Yeah.
That's a good story point. Yeah. But he's just the same stuff. And even though I will say that 13 Hours is probably his best thing to date in a very long time anyway.
I like 13 Hours of Love.
Well, he focused more on story. Yeah. And it still had that Michael Bay music video flair to it, but it's just the guy's just not a great storyteller. He's a great visual director for sure, and action is always fun to watch, but I think that's to me why I don't like his stuff, because it just, he doesn't care for, and I've also heard behind the scenes stuff of the way he looks at stuff, he doesn't care about trying to sell the audience on emotion and story. He just tries to blow things up and make things look cool. Mm-hmm. All right, what's next?
Itamar Avidan asks, was Captain America Civil War released too early for critics? Got all the hype now and marketing, but the movie still has a month to
go. I want to weigh in on this, because I think whether it will affect the box office, I doubt it. But I think that this is a little weird, and it's making me like, yeah. And granted, you know, I know the reviews are like gangbusters, right? And that's great. But I found myself going, wait a second. Oh, when does it come out, next weekend? Well, no. Does it come out? When does it come out? And it comes out in May. I haven't seen the movie yet, and I think that the way that we as fans and film people live and online in a community, it's the fact that you've got all these people super hyped and they've already seen it. You know, the rest of the audience isn't able to weigh in the conversation that's happening a month before they're able to contribute. That, to me, is curious.
It's not so curious to me because of what...
Because you've seen it?
Well, yes. I was going to say, the thing that makes me angry about the early thing is I haven't seen it yet.
Yeah, I haven't seen it either.
No, but I think that what they've done in the past with... I mean, even the first Avengers, Ultron, they've released it in Europe. Like, I think it's... When does it come out, the release? I think it comes out, like, next week in Europe, I think.
Mm. And if they're... European.
Well, but if that's the case, it's like you let the critics and everyone see it first, especially if you have confidence in it. Then it goes up next week in Europe, and then it's okay. The hype happens there because it's a different world as far as a lot of people. Look, we have a lot of international viewers that are watching this show right now, and we put our review up here at Collider, and maybe they're going to see it next week, and
lucky
they're on the fence about it, or maybe they want to see it, or whatever. They're going to see it anyway. But the hype behind it, Disney knew that they had a good movie. The same thing with Jungle Book. There was no embargo for it. It's like they knew they had a good movie, and they want critics to talk about it. 3 weeks almost a month is soon for sure though too. But I think it's because they are waiting because it is that hype train, and maybe it was an experiment. They want to see what happens, because you're also going to remember the Russo brothers went on that big promotion thing. We have our interview that's up on a Collider. Dennis is that's up right now. Yes. Okay. So Dennis's interview with the Russo brothers is up on the channel right now. Myself and Mark, we were able to talk to them. They were everywhere. I mean, they were everywhere that they're promoting it. So I think this is a strategy for sure.
I think what a cool thing would be if you want to even take it the next step further is Marvel charters a plane and fans win a chance to fly to Europe and see it before the American fans kind of do. Because I think that it's almost unfair a little bit to the American fans congratulations, international, that fantastic. But I think you release it everywhere the same worldwide, unless there's some sort of, you know, tariffs or I don't know, whatever international stuff people have to do. But I think it's unfair to us. I do. I don't know why. I don't know. That's just me being
American. It's because we aren't able to contribute to the conversation. I mean, look at Batman v Superman. That is a perfect example. People went to see this movie because everyone wanted to talk about it.
Right.
And they're fans of the characters, of course. That goes without saying, guys. But no, I mean, really, like, that created such a conversation, digital platforms amongst people in person. And I'm so frustrated that everybody is talking about Civil War and I can't contribute.
You will.
I know, but
if
it'll
anybody
be
out
boring
there gets advanced screening passes, Clark and I would like to go.
Yes, we would really like to go.
No, it's just you guys. I didn't get to have the cool toy first.
Yeah. Right. I didn't get to have the cool toy like third. Yeah. I mean,
let's take two more.
Okay, Adrian Kitma asks, can you see a Deadpool Spider-Man crossover like a Fox Sony crossover? Miller and Kinberg were quoted talking about it.
Yeah, I don't care what they were quoted talking about. It's not going to happen because I saw a cool mailbag question also about whether or not they think that it's that Fox and Marvel have kind of been in cahoots, that they're going to do something together eventually. I don't, because you remember Sony was like drowning. They were drowning and they were going to lose Spider-Man. So the Marvel was just he was like the wolf in Pulp Fiction. And they came in there and they saved Sony. But I don't think that the X-Men franchise has proven that Fox doesn't need to be saved right now. They don't need to be part of that universe. And I don't think they want to get in bed with Marvel right now. So I just don't see it happening.
Well, also with the tonally, it doesn't work.
Unless you made Spider-Man cool.
That yes, unless Spider-Man suddenly becomes cool, but not teenage high school Spider-Man that is in the family-friendly MCU. That doesn't make sense to cross him over with Deadpool, right?
Next,
that's what I'm in.
Last one.
Oh yeah.
All right. The Dutch movie guy asks, "We know that Clark is the underdog, but I want to hear why she is going to win anyway in the Schmodown."
Ooh, for those of you guys who don't know, the Schmodown is coming. We have been doing a movie trivia Schmodown here every week. We started about 3 weeks ago. And by the way, thank you to you guys. I think the Campiest Match is up to 130,000 right now, and Manson Roker is about 120. It is really building, and you guys have been contributing and enjoying it. And here are our two contestants for tomorrow. You got Clarke Wolfe, who is brand new to this league, against the number two contender here, Josh Macuga. Clarke, you could take away Macuga's title shot if you beat him. Why do you have a shot to do this?
I sure could. Look, I you know, have been a fan of the Schmoes audience, or the Schmoes guys, for a long time. We're all friends off camera.
And are we though, Schmoes?
Except for Josh. I'm not. We're not friends at all. Mm-hmm. But who likes that guy?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The worst.
I'm a rogue one, guys.
The rogue one, Josh Macuga. But no, so I've seen that you guys have done this league, and like behind the scenes, I've kind of been like, oh, that's kind of cool. Like, I like movies too. I'd want to play. And, you know, this time I thought, okay, then I was asked to participate. And, you know, look, I know you guys, maybe you guys don't know this about me, but I love movies. I love entertainment, and I love all kinds of movies. And
Clark, you know what? I like graham crackers. I love In-N-Out. Congratulations. Does that translate to loving movie trivia? No. Here's what it translates to. It translates to me being the best at everything I do.
You're pretty Gonzaga-ish.
Yeah, right now. Okay? No, what it is, Clark, is that you have a lot of confidence going in. You went to film school. Congratulations. You have a lot of DVDs. Congratulations. What you don't have is confidence. I come everywhere with confidence. Last night, I went to Chipotle, 2 burritos. I only ate 1.5 of them, but it was a lot of confidence.
Yeah, well, the thing is with Macuga is that if you ever want to go back and watch the old 2014 tournament, Macuga was counted out in the first round. And made it all the way to the finals and almost beat Mark Riley. So that's why he's standing at number 2. If he wins, he is going to play the winner of both Mark Riley and JTE for the title. So again, tomorrow, make sure that you check out that match between Josh Macuga and Clarke Wolfe for the movie trivia Schmodown. I would like to thank you guys for tuning in today. We have a lot of great stuff here happening on Collider. Obviously, we have movie talk every day of the week. Collider Jedi Council, Collider Heroes, TV Talk, the brand new movie news segments that we have putting up every day. Those have been a blast as well. So many great and fun shows here that want you guys to be involved. Subscribe, share them, talk about them, get it going on Twitter at Collider Video. Natasha, where can they find you first?
You all can find me on Instagram and Twitter at NatashaLexis_, as well as Facebook/NatashaLexisMartinez. And don't forget to watch me on Collider News today and tomorrow.
And we have the two competitors in tomorrow's Schmodown. First, the classy one, Clarke Wolfe.
You guys can find me and my statement necklace on the interwebs at Clarke Wolfe, Clarke with an E, Wolfe with an E. And tomorrow you can find me kicking Josh Macuga's on the Schmodown.
And the number two contender himself, Josh the Wild Man Macuga.
Yeah, you can find me without a statement necklace at Josh Macuga on Twitter and Instagram here every Monday on Collider TV Talk. Guys, thank you so much for watching TV Talk. It's been a blast. All the views, all the comments, really, really respect all you guys. Thanks for sending in the questions and everything. We love hearing from you. And you guys can go to my YouTube channel, The Josh Macuga Show. And tomorrow on the Schmodown, you can see me taking on the wolf like Liam Neeson took on a black one with liquor bottles.
There you go, guys. So again, thank you guys very much. We will see you back tomorrow.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.